Hey, Days of Our Lives fans, I hope you're ready and got your questions all lined up because we've got Guy Wilson with us, so stay tuned.
You're tuning into the destination for TV superfan discussion, AfterBuzz TV. And now, let the buzz begin.
Well, hello, all of you Days of Our Lives fans. Welcome to AfterBuzz TV's Spotlight On, where we here revisit with some of our lovable cast from the hit NBC soap opera Days of Our Lives. I'm your host, Tony Moore, and I am joined by a gaggle of folks, starting, of course, to my very far, 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 far left.
Should I move over?
Yeah, you're not far enough.
Not far enough. Mark J. Freeman!
And, of course, we have our very special guest in the house, Mr. Guy Wilson.
Hi.
How are you, sir?
Welcome, Guy.
Round of applause. We usually have an applause effect, but we'll do it live. And, of course, I can't forget about my wonderful co-host.
Oh, because I'm not wonderful?
Well, you know.
Because Guy's not wonderful?
Well, I have to. There's certain people,
yeah,
you know, you have to give things to.
I know. This one.
Handsome, lovable, oh, Matthew Evan Paine.
We've just gone over time.
All right, so we are going to revisit some of the lovely moments of Days of Our Lives with Mr. Guy Wilson and also catch up with him and find out what has he been up to since his unfortunate demise.
Should we start there?
Should we start with the bad and then go back and forward?
Because some of us were a little upset.
Well,
It was the most upsetting murder on Days of Our Lives, I think, in recent history.
Thank you.
How was it doing those scenes? You managed to give the most moving performance on your exit, knowing you were leaving.
Thank you.
How was that?
You know, I think. Certainly, there was a lot of sadness I was feeling. I think part of what made those final 2 weeks, and certainly that last week, so especially surreal, is when you're in the daytime world and you're coming to work to the same place every day, day in and day out, for literally years.
Mm-hmm.
You sort of take for granted, you know, the notion that it's going to be there for you the next day. And so suddenly, when you're in the home stretch and you're, you know, building this roadmap in your mind of how this series of scenes are going to go, they're going to lead to your character, to your death. It was very emotionally affecting for me. You know, it's just you take it for granted. You know, and if anything, it's a microcosm. You know, for being grateful for life because you never know. You know,
right?
Because it's, you know, when you're on a soap and when you're, you know, have the privilege of playing a character like Will Horton, you feel like,
who's
okay,
half Brady, half,
you know,
Horton.
That's about as legacy as it
that's
gets.
That's like staying power.
Yeah.
You were born in, and then they were like, nope.
Yeah.
Uh-uh.
Yeah. Yeah.
Not so fast, fans.
And Allison Sweeney was very vocal about them killing off your character.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that had to have been a huge shock.
It was. I mean, it was a shock for everyone, and it was absolutely a shock for me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I found out, two, maybe 3 weeks after they had hired the new writers, Dina Higley and Josh Griffith.
Mm-hmm.
And after they'd been hired, you know, there's always this there's always some turnover,
right.
You know,
mm-hmm.
I think
everybody knows.
Yeah, yeah. It mm-hmm. happens for a myriad of reasons,
mm-hmm.
But it always happens.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, we all knew some changes were going to happen. We didn't know to what extent. We didn't know who or when. But we knew it was inevitable. And so when I got the call from one of our executive producers, I was shocked. It felt like I was in a dream. I felt like I was underwater
mm-hmm.
for the next couple hours. I just sort of sat there sort of stunned, really.
Yeah.
What was the call like?
You know, it's the call in and of itself was as sweet and, you know, as compassionate as can be. It was our executive producer, Albert Allar, who is a dear friend of mine, you know, irrespective mm-hmm. of our time working together. And,
mm-hmm.
you know, he's a great human being. I really loved working with him. And so in hindsight, I'm grateful it was him who made the call. It's not that I really got along with everyone. I didn't, you know, everyone had a great attitude there.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, even if it was someone else who made the call, I mean, I'm just not really a confrontational person. I wouldn't have gotten upset, but the fact that it was from Albert made it feel, in hindsight, a little more gentle. It was like, okay, at least it's like,
it's like mom.
Yeah.
He's being sweet about it.
You're leaving.
Yeah, and the other thing too is I could sense even in the moment just how difficult it was for him mm-hmm. to be making that call. And you know, he assured me it wasn't, you know, his decision, and this, you know, it came down from on high. And yeah, I don't want to put him in a tough spot by asking specific questions about who and why.
Right.
Why me? That's just not fair to him, and it just wouldn't have solved anything. But I know that, you know, when I got the call from Albert, it was, I mean, it was official. And I had something like, what, 5-6 weeks notice, something like that. Which seems like a lot, also doesn't seem like a lot to me. It just depends. Yeah. Everything just happened really quick. As soon as they brought in the new riders, everything began to transition.
Yeah.
You know, and it took a little while for everything to be revealed on screen, but behind the scenes, these transitions were already in motion.
In motion.
Yeah.
Just to piggyback off of what Matthew was saying earlier with the scene when Ben killed Will,
mm-hmm.
those were some of the hardest scenes, I think, as fans for us to watch, because it was a moment of watching... Yeah, it was a moment of watching Will, which, I mean, you played that so well, of Will discovering that he was the necktie killer, and then that struggle, and then the actual strangling, and, like, for the first time, like, seeing the actual strangle and you looking at him and him looking at you, like, that was some of the most chilling scenes to watch. And I think for us as fans, it hit us like, oh shit, sorry. Like, they're killing Will, and like, it was so tough. And I remember that week, it was hard for us as fans, for us to even accept that they decided to kill Will.
It
didn't seem real at all. And everyone has had nothing but great things. We've had, like, Deidre Hall and Allison Sweeney, mm-hmm. and everyone coming. Freddie came in, and they had nothing but amazing things to say about you.
I'm kidding.
But I mean, one of the things taking over the character of Will, I'm sure it was like a blink of an eye transition from Chandler mm-hmm. to you. Were you nervous going into this role, knowing the legacy of the character? What were your feelings like taking over the role of Will?
You know, I think that in the very, very, very beginning, going mm-hmm. in, I think to a certain degree, you know, ignorance was bliss. I was acutely aware of how important Will Horton was within the context of, you know, the LGBT movement and, mm-hmm. and marriage equality and where that storyline was, where they wanted it to go. So I was aware of that, mm-hmm. and that was immensely exciting for me. But what I think I was ignorant toward in the beginning was just how deep of a legacy character Will Horton was. I mean, he mm-hmm. was born and raised on the show, you know? And so I was walking into this actor's dream of a situation where these wonderful storylines, really juicy relationships.
Mm-hmm.
And at surface value, I thought, well, this is great. You know, I've, you know, won the Super Bowl. This is fantastic. But, you know, in the time that followed since I began doing Will, and even still, you know, after the show, after being on the show, the scale to which I've discovered that, you know, the Will Horton affects people, you know, mm-hmm. all the way down to literally his infancy, you know, that was just so far over my head, you know, because growing up, you know, if a soap opera was on TV, you know, I'd watch it a little bit, but really I just wanted cartoons, you know, if I was a little kid.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, I've always had this reverence and this respect for soap operas as an institution, because mm-hmm. they span generations over decades, you know, and they're part of this nation's zeitgeist, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. They're very under... I think they're under-respected. Not disrespected, but under-respected. And that, all of that is, I've only just come to appreciate within the last, you know, 2 years, you know? And so getting in, you know, in the beginning as Will Horton, it's like if I could go back and do it again, yes, I'd be excited to play Will Horton, but but I'd be really excited to be back a part of that kind of an institution that does reach so many people all over the country.
Yeah. And I also read that you said that Deidre Hall actually had a lot with you, had a lot to do with you feeling comfortable and getting started.
In the very in the role. Absolutely. When I first, everyone was...
She says hi, by the way.
Oh, well, I should send her a text right after this. Hi, Deidre. She was amazing. Everyone was very supportive. And she, I think, where she really helped me immensely is because she's Deidre Hall. I mean, she's sort of a demigod in television. Yeah. You know, I mean, mm-hmm. she is a goddess, you know?
Yeah.
And for her to go out of her way and to... put it this way, if she hadn't have gone out of her way, if she had just kept doing her job, like, I still would have been in awe of her.
Yeah, yeah.
Right. She carries herself with such regency and grace. She's so intelligent. that whenever I'm in the room with her, I'm just like, just learn, just soak it up, soak it up, soak it up, yeah. You know. Mm-hmm. But no, she'd invite me into her you know, her dressing room with you know, with our script coach, and we'd just go over the scenes and talk about the relationship between Will and Marlene, mm-hmm. the history of that relationship and how it's evolved. Those are the types of things that you just you can't get it unless someone tells you, unless the person, the source, tells you.
Right.
Yeah. And so that was, it gave me so much confidence, you know, because I knew who she was. You know, it's I wasn't an expert on Days when I came in. I knew who she was. Mm-hmm. I knew who Sammy was.
Right. Yeah.
And I knew who Lucas Orton was. You know what I mean? And,
the important people.
Yes. And I knew Sonny. And I knew who Sonny was. But but beyond those pivotal characters, I didn't really know much, but I knew enough to know that for Deidre Hall to be kind, it was huge.
What was your audition like for the role of Will?
So it's interesting. When I think about it, in certain ways, the audition almost spanned over the course of 2 years. Because originally in 2011, I was on the short list to play Sonny at Kyriakis.
I love when
you're leading
out.
Into Tony's next question.
It's always the next question, because I always love finding out what people audition for
prior to getting
their role.
I also auditioned for Ben's character, Rob Wilson's character, Ben.
Yeah.
They actually held auditions for that character months before I went in for Will. And I don't know if they just put the character on the shelf and then brought him out later. But that character, the character of Ben, had been floating around since early 2013. Mm. I'm sorry, early 2000. Yeah, 13.
Wow.
Yeah.
Oh, see, I love that.
Yeah. So in 2011, I'm on the short list. I, you know, went in about 6 or 7 times, and it was down to me and like 3 other guys. They were testing for the role of Sonny Kyriakis. Mm. And I felt like it went great. I did my test with Judy Evans, and loved her, and got sort of a call from my agent saying it's unofficial, but it looks like they're going to go with you for the role of Sonny. And I was just over the moon, you know what I mean? Because keep in mind, this is, 5 years ago, over five years ago. And then a day went by, and another day went by, and I got a call saying my manager called and said, there's a problem. And I said, what's that? And he says, well, everyone at Days loves you, but there's an executive at NBC who's concerned about casting you. And I said, why? And he said, he or she, to this day, I still don't know if it was a he or she. I don't know who it was. I don't really care anymore. But this individual feels that you look too much like Chandler Massey, and this person is concerned about having two people in a relationship that look like siblings. And I said,
perfect relationship. That's how all relationships look. You always look like the person you're dating.
We're all narcissists anyway. It makes sense.
And he was gay. That's perfect. Who at NBC did not see that?
That's what I literally said that to my agent. I was like, people love that.
Yeah.
They love seeing that. You know.
Yeah.
And then I said, well, I'll dye my hair. Like, it's not difficult.
Yeah.
It's an easy fix. So, and they said, no, they really want someone who just naturally looks a little bit more, you know, counter to Chandler. Mm-hmm. And they said, but, you know, Day still really likes you. They'll have you test again, but this time you're going to go up against some other guys that have darker hair, or just a different look than you. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, okay. You know, and at that point, I just had a bad feeling about it. And did the test. It went great. You know, and still they said, look, there's nothing you could have done differently.
Yeah.
But they're going to cast this other kid, Freddie Smith. Yeah. And I remember meeting Freddie briefly, like in that morning before the test. And he was, you know, just super friendly. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, I didn't really think much of it. I just remember thinking, oh, all right, well, this kid's okay.
Yeah.
And then, toward the end of 2011, now, fast forward about 8 or 9 months, I'm at LA Fitness over in Universal City, and I'm parked.
What is LA Fitness? I'm kidding.
Oh, no. We call it La Fitness sometimes.
Fitness.
It's so ubiquitous out here. Yeah, yeah. I'm walking in the drive, the parking garage to the gym, and I hear this, hey, and I turn, and it's this you know, good-looking, dark-haired kid with this goofy grin on his face walking up to me, and he says, hey, you're a guy, right? And I said, yeah, who are you? And he says, my name's Freddie Smith, and I remember you, because you tested for Days, and I saw your tape, you were really good. And I said, thank you, that's really nice. And I said, yeah, I tested for Sonny. He said, yeah, me too. And I said, oh, yeah, man, I heard, and I literally said this, because I thought, and somehow in my head, I thought this was true. I said, I heard that they hired some, like dark Latin model for the role or something like that, because that's really what I thought, because I wasn't watching the show, and he laughed. He says, no, they, They cast me. I got the part. He's almost like kind of like me, you know, because he's not some tall, dark Latin model.
Right, right.
And so I felt like an ass. So I said, I'm sorry. I didn't mean like that. So no, it's okay. And we ended up, you know, just chatting and hanging out, see him at the gym a lot. And so we developed this friendship independent of
That's
Days.
So funny.
You know, of course, we met because we were on set of Days, but we met and sort of had this nice, friendly acquaintance, completely independent of the show. And so now. 2013 comes around, so 2 years have transpired, over 2 years, because I think that the
And you're just doing your thing at this point.
Mm-hmm, yeah, and I get a call in August, so in August of 2013, so almost 3 years ago, at like 9 a.m. from my agent, and they say, guy, Marnie, who's the casting director over at Days, wants to see you today for this role. There's about 8 pages of sides, and she'd really love it if you could be off book. And none of this is abnormal, but for them to want it all on the same day out of the blue is a little abnormal. And so I said, what's it about? And they said, well, they couldn't give us any details, but they really want to see you today. And I said, well, yeah, okay, great. I'll be there. And so I, you know, get on the phone, I call, you know, one of my acting coaches, I said, can we run this? There's something going on, I have no idea what it is. So I get there around like 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And I go in, and I look around, and there's no one there. And usually when you go to a casting call so for the most part, it's usually pretty packed, because they see a lot of people, and they're very, you know, very open with that, which is it's annoying when you don't want to see other actors, but it's great that they see a lot of actors. But I walk in, and there's no one. It's just me. And all of a sudden, her assistant, Bob, who's one of my favorite people ever, poked his head out of his office, and he says, Guy, hey, can I get you a water? And I'm like, they are treating me so nicely. Like, what did I do? Like, did someone? Yeah. I was just unaccustomed to it. Mm-hmm. You know, Marnie comes out. We go in. We do the scene. She says, "That's great." And she gave me a couple notes. And then she said, "Here's what's going to happen. We're going to go downstairs, and we're going to meet with Greg Meng, the executive producer of the show, and you're going to do this scene." And just do it just the way we did, just be relaxed. And I said, okay, sure. So I said, what is, and she said, so, ... And that's when she didn't mention his name. Here's the thing, I'm like, I could have easily, if I knew the show, I would have known who she was talking about.
Right.
But she, you know, just for the sake of being proper, she said that there's an individual on the show who has expressed an interest in moving on from the show. However, you know, the writers and the producers are really happy with where this character's storyline is. And we want to keep the storyline going. And I feel, and I think they will feel, this is all Marnie speaking, you know, that you are, you know, an ideal candidate to continue work within this role. Mm-hmm. And then I realized who she was talking about.
Yeah.
And I said, yes. I want this, you know.
Yeah.
So we went downstairs and did the scene for Greg. It was just Greg and Marnie in this massive conference room. It was kind of intimidating. Because when you act, you're usually in a tiny room, and there's just a couple chairs and a camera, but there's this massive conference table down the center of the room. So Greg's on one side of the conference table, and I'm on the other. And it's hard to pretend that there's not this massive table between you, and you just, it felt a little claustrophobic. But, everything happened the way it was meant to happen. And he gave me some great feedback, and the next day they had me sign a test deal, and then that night, I did the test. It was at the end of the shooting day for them, and they were already running over. So we did the test around like 7:30 p.m., which is very, very late for a daytime crew to still be working. We did the test with Freddie. Freddie did not know that I was reading for that role. They thought I was coming on to sort of be this, you know, like this, maybe some, you know, someone who tries to come between them, you know, like a heavy recurring character.
Gotcha.
So I wasn't supposed to tell him that. So there's all these little, the whole experience was a soap opera in itself.
Wow.
Because everyone knew something that someone else didn't know. Just as I'm sure there was so much going on that I didn't know.
Right.
You know? But showed up, hit my mark, knew my lines, and called me the next day. And that changed a lot. So that's the epic response to your question. But it was, if they hadn't have tested me in 2011, they never would have brought me in 2013.
They have such a crazy memory of people who come in.
Yeah.
And I think in general too, and any actor, working actor knows that you always get told in your classes, you're not auditioning for that part, you're auditioning for the next part.
Exactly.
Always be ready and be prepared, because even though you're not getting that, they're going to remember you and you're going to bring you back.
That's right. I'm taking notes for my time.
It's true.
How quickly did you start after they called you?
As it happened, it could have been the next day. As it happened that day, that was a Friday, No, I'm sorry. That was the test was the Thursday night. So they offered me the contract the next day, Friday. But that whole following week was a hiatus week. So there was 9 days. So, you know, the work week plus the two weekends. So 9 days. It was just torture where I had to wait and then come back and work that following week. And even that following week, I was off that Monday. So I think it was 10 days of just sitting on this and just wanting to go to work, but I can't. And then finally, I went to work. My first day shooting was in September. The first week of September.
And what was that like?
I was so nervous and just a little just nervous, but not like I didn't want to be there. Nervous, just I wanted to do it. And our set of scenes, we're just shooting a portion of that episode. So it was only two or three scenes, and it was at the end of the day. And when you're only on at the end of the day, your call time is about 3 p.m. It's middle of the afternoon. So I woke up that morning like 7 a.m. wide awake. At the like it's like 3 p.m. Couldn't come soon enough. I got there at 2:15. I got there 45 minutes early and just, you know, sat in my waiting room, and I don't know anybody. And because everyone's like working, it's not really the time to like schmooze and like get to know each other, because I want to like let people do their job. You know. But I just kind of hung out in the makeup room watching the monitor broadcast the day, and finally it was time to get up there. And then we get up there and we start doing it, and right away they wanted to make some adjustments to, like, you know, my hair and this and that. I didn't realize it then, but I realize now, like, the amount of pressure they must have been feeling. Like, forget what I'm feeling. Let me hear these writers, these producers, these showrunners who they have all this pressure to keep this legacy character going strong and to keep this groundbreaking storyline going, you know. And so in my mind, I'm thinking, oh, it's all about me, I gotta do this right. But really, you know, the fate of a show rests on them getting the decision right.
Right.
It's like, it's not my, you know, it's they're the ones who have to make sure I fit. It's not, you know what I mean? So fortunately, they liked what they saw enough to keep me going.
Now, entering into the role of Will, there were fans who had very mixed reviews about your portrayal of Will. Side note, I thought that you were a very mature Will, so thought, again, you did a very great job stepping into the role. But for you as an actor, how did you feel kind of hearing what fans were saying, and how did you, did that affect you, and like, how did you feel about what was being said, or if you even paid attention to what was being said about your portrayal?
I love that you're asking me this now, you know, today, but certainly now that all this time has transpired, I think up to that point, you know, in my career, I've had success, you know, enough, you know, that I've been able to, you know, make a modest living as an actor and you know, been on a bunch of different shows, but never on a show or a film that had such an established following, you know. And so for me, it was sort of a crash course education in how to you know, take in information and take it in analytically, but not personally, if that makes sense. You know, because it's when fanboys and fangirls, like, you know, feel strongly about something, it's not on you. If they love you, great, and if they don't love you, it doesn't really matter. You know what I mean? Because like, what they love ultimately is bigger than what you could ever be.
Right.
You know what I mean? And so in the beginning, I felt like it was like junior high school again. You know what I mean? I'm like, well, why are you telling me that? Like, it's like, I never met you before. You know? And everyone
isn't
in the
social media great.
Oh my god, I still can't tell if it's the best thing or the worst.
Yeah,
thing.
I know.
I still cannot tell if it's God sent or Satan sent.
Well, speaking of, I said that I did get a question from somebody. Right to Loves asked. She said she's a huge fan of your Will, and what was it like to have the negativity regarding your version of Will out there, which is what you're answering, but I just wanted to
get and that's a great question. It's
I'll say this too.
Yeah.
Give you time to think, because I always go to this, because I love Miss Lauren Koslow.
Oh, yeah.
When she was here, we talked a lot about her taking over for Deborah Adair, who I loved Deborah Adair as Kate. And she said something that I just, you know, and I'm a part of the theater world as well, and started doing theater. So when she said this, it kind of really hit home, and I think this really kind of goes for you, because whether they liked your Will or not, and whether they're being nasty to you about it or not, it's your Will. It was her response was she had done theater. So her Hamlet, let's say, is going to be different than your Hamlet.
Like, yeah.
But it's my still presentation the character, of this character.
Yeah.
So I think that's the same with you, is it was just a different Will. Mm-hmm. You know, yeah. And if you like that kind of a Will, you're gonna like Chandler. You yeah. know, if you like this kind of Will, you're gonna like you. You know, yeah.
That's an excellent. I couldn't have broken down. Couldn't have broken it down. Even better.
Yeah. Thank you.
In the moment, it took me. That whole thing took it. It really forced me to mature quickly when it comes to just being, you know, confident in self. Because yeah. it's like you said, I need to have faith in my abilities, in my training, mm-hmm. and my intuition as an artist, yeah. and just trust that I'm portraying this role truthfully. Mm-hmm. Chandler Massey is one of the most amazing actors I've ever yeah. seen. The mm-hmm. kid is so talented, yeah. and he did amazing things with this character. And I think it'd be foolhardy for anybody, let alone me, to try to do a better Chandler than what Chandler can
right.
do.
Exactly.
You know? So I think one thing I did correct from the beginning and was not trying to emulate Chandler. Mm-hmm. You know, I just wanted to bring a level of truth, of veracity to Will Horton.
Right.
You know, just to at least match what Chandler did. Yeah. You know, and then continue exploring where things, you know, left off.
Yeah.
For me, the character of Will, and I've said this before. You know, it's. I mean, any soap character is going to be a fun character, but Will Horton and Sonny Kyriakis, I think those are two real gems, you know, in the history and the world of soap opera. And so, for me, I'm, you know, I've always been a little bit crushed that I'm not playing Will anymore. But whether or not I'm playing Will, I would just love to see Will come back.
Yeah.
You know, I think what he did for the show is so much greater than just a cliffhanger that leads to a yeah. soap commercial. You
exactly.
know what I mean? And that's to me is what's saddest. Because it's like now that all this time has passed, it's for a while I was very egoic and insecure in my head, like, oh, I've got to be better than Chandler. You know, it's yeah. like I always knew I can't do what Chandler does. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to be more well-loved than Chandler because Chandler yeah. is so immensely loved.
Yeah.
And I got into my head and I realized about, it took me a little while, you know, I realized it's not about whether people like me more than him. It's just, is the character resonating with viewers?
Yeah.
It has
yeah.
nothing to do with me. It has to do with what Will Horton is doing.
Yeah. If Days of Our Lives asked to bring Will back and asked you, Guy, to portray him again, would you?
Would you like a paycheck?
Everyone wants a paycheck. I would. I feel like 95% of myself is ready to slam my fist down and be like, absolutely.
Yeah.
And then there's a 5% of me is like, okay, well, let's keep in mind what wasn't, you know, what wasn't great about it, or just keep to the forefront of my mind what would need to be done differently so it can be better than it was before.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I'm talking about the entire experience.
Right, exactly.
You know what I mean? From
yeah.
top to bottom, the whole show. You know?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So the answer is yes, I'd love to. I also know that it's just not a reality that's in front of me.
Yeah.
At the moment.
Well,
let's just say if the three of us were writing for Days,
okay,
a lot of people would come back from the dead.
Yes.
And we've actually created
yes.
ways for certain people to come back, so we would make it happen. And it can happen, for crying out
that's
loud.
That's so true.
Yeah. So many people have come back from the dead.
Yeah,
so I don't
know,
get me started.
I would vote for Will to come back from the dead and with a friend, Maxine's son. You know, just saying, I'm still gonna keep throwing y'all out there until it happens. I could be like this, like, you know. Never mind, it's not about me. Anyway,
let me ask another Twitter question.
Yes.
Should we get to this? Should I ask? Am I allowed to ask this?
Yeah, you can ask.
Okay.
You can ask
so this
you
is from. The Twitter name is new_flash_pros. Well, first asked, this is a three-pronger. Your favorite scene with Freddie, your favorite scene with Christopher. You answer those, and then we'll get to the third cliffhanger question.
Okay.
Mark.
So the first two questions, favorite scene with Freddie, favorite scene with Christopher.
And Freddie and Christopher are watching, by the way.
They're watching this right now?
Absolutely.
Okay.
I don't know that they are. I'm hoping
someone will send them. They'll send them. I'm sure someone will send them clips.
Yes.
I mean, there's so many scenes I love doing with Freddie and with Christopher. I think with Freddie, the first thing that pops into mind, and I know it's cliche, but when he was giving his wedding vows
yeah.
in the wedding scene.
Oh.
That was amazing. to stand, you know, just to watch it as a viewer, but then to be, like, in that as,
yeah.
as the character. That was powerful. I always loved doing scenes with Freddie, like in the club, in Sonny's club,
mm-hmm.
going in, and he's always, like, stressed out about work. Because there's something about Freddie Smith playing stressed out that cracks
yeah.
me up.
Yeah.
He's just not like
yeah.
a stressy kind of guy.
Yeah.
Right.
So whenever he's, I don't know, I just enjoy that. It tickles
yeah.
me. With Christopher, I think I was a part of history when I was there in the scene when he came out to his grandfather
right.
in Japanese.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That to me was just I mean, I could, the rest of my career, I might never be a part of something as powerful as that.
Yeah.
Just in terms of what it was, but also just how it was executed. Mm-hmm. That, but then also those earlier scenes between, with Christopher, to where when Will was interviewing Paul for the story, Paul was just beginning to try to flirt with him,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
And there was this whole like conversation beneath the conversation that mm-hmm. was happening, and that was a lot of fun. That was fun because Christopher nailed it. So it's like we were really, as an actor, we're basically playing two different scenes, which is great. That was a lot of fun. Now, as far as the kissing.
Well, we didn't ask yet.
Oh, okay.
So they don't know what we're talking about.
Oh, they don't know what the last one was.
We know what we're talking about. You know. So then he wanted, the third question was, who is a better kisser, Freddie or Christopher?
Ooh. That's such a shady
I just had a shady question.
Okay, I'm just
They're gonna, both the same.
My hands are sweating.
But they're not.
But they're not.
Mine are not. I'm sitting here like this.
This is the clip of the show that's going to get played
over and over and over again.
What minute are we at in the
I don't know. It doesn't say.
Yeah.
All right, go ahead, guys.
I was just
waiting.
Christopher's lips are the best. They're like so soft and like but I think Freddie is the better kisser. Christopher, I like Christopher's lips, but Freddie.
His
mechanics are a little bit more consistent.
Look at
good
that.
Job, boys.
That
was and the pretty. Only way to know if he's telling the truth is for both of you guys to come back to AfterBuzz and kiss
and
us.
We'll test them
Wait,
out
kiss
and see
us?
If you're telling the truth.
Well, I'm sharing the love. I'm not going to just take them off
myself.
What was
Billy Flynn thing?
I didn't say Billy. Billy came in here. You bitches ain't coming near him. But he laid a couple surprise little smackers on you, didn't he, Billy Flynn?
Oh, yeah. He kept kissing my head.
Yeah.
No, I that was like that was not in the script.
Yeah.
He just did it in the rehearsal, and I was like, Billy, that was great. I was like the Godfather. Do that again.
Yeah.
And he was like, okay, yeah. But it was his idea, and I as soon as he did, I was like, that's some Demira. Right there. That's great.
That's my boy.
Yeah. So one of the big things with the character of Will was the fact that he was a gay character on Days, which you know it came at a time during the big LGBT movement, and you know we saw the wedding of Will and Sunny, which was such a beautiful moment. And then of course there has to be a wonderful gay storyline with someone just coming in and like totally wrecking shop. For you and Freddie and Christopher, did you guys feel pressure to make sure that this storyline, you know, resonated with the LGBT community? Like, how did that feel for you guys doing this storyline and having it out there, doing this like movement that was happening?
I wouldn't use the word pressure because I don't want to give a connotation that there was any sort of, you know, negative, fear or concern. I mean, there was more sort of like, we knew that the stakes were high, but certainly speaking for myself, I always felt, certainly for myself, and I think I can speak for all three of us, I think we all felt pretty confident mm-hmm. that we could pull it off, you know, because the way it all came about, you know, once it came out that Will cheated on Sonny, you know, with Paul, you know, at that point, the writing gets a little, it got a little, I don't know,
no,
we can
did.
Get into
yeah.
that later,
yeah.
oh.
But up until that, up
yeah.
until, you know, that, you know, to when Will, you know, stepped into the garden, of, you know, and did, you know, did what he did with Paul, I felt like the writing was working. I liked it. I thought it was, there was just all, like we were saying before, all this doublespeak going
mm-hmm,
on.
Mm-hmm.
And I just had so much confidence in Christopher and Freddie's abilities. I never felt any lack of confidence that we couldn't pull it off.
Right.
I just, you know, and I think we were all very excited, again, to be doing something that had such greater ramifications beyond just getting ratings,
right.
you know, and selling ad space.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, I was more, like, I was getting high off of that. Like, I just loved the fact that I was doing something that was, you know, potentially helping people,
yeah.
you know, like, you know, reconcile conflict within their lives.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I you know, I go to a CrossFit gym. But because I do CrossFit, I have to tell you I do CrossFit.
That's right. You have to explain to me what that CrossFit. Is. I have no idea.
Yeah, well, we'll talk.
I can be your new project.
So I'm at my CrossFit gym. This is about six, seven, I don't know, sometime in the last year. And this guy who I'd seen there a few times comes up to me after the workout, and he says, "You're on days, right?"
You meet a lot of people at this gym thing.
At CrossFit?
At gyms in general.
Oh, yeah,
maybe I should go.
You should.
I mean, I'm married. Don't get me wrong. I'm just saying it's a social event.
Sorry, it is a social event. No, this young man comes up to me and said, "You're Will Horton." And I said, "I am." Well, you know, I'm dead now. Yeah. But he says, "Yeah, but you don't understand. Your wedding with Sonny, you know, my grandmother who lives in," he said, "some southern, I want to say like Arkansas or Alabama." Yeah. So right. That part of the country, right. And mm-hmm. not to say like that, but yeah, that part of the country.
We understand.
Yeah. Yeah. said when after she saw, you know, your wedding scene, she called me up and said that she was sorry for not being present at mine and my husband's wedding. And she said seeing that, you know, the relationship with Sonny and Will all of a sudden showed her that there's nothing wrong, you know, with her being supportive of her own family and their relationships. And it's when that to me was worth all of it, you know.
Well, we talked a lot about it on here because mm-hmm. when we started doing this, it wasn't too far into us doing this that all this started happening.
Yeah.
And this was before Matthew was with us, but the other host we had, we were all gay. And we were getting, we actually were getting gay-ish.
They're not anymore. They were.
But we were getting a lot of flack because we weren't vocal enough about the fact that they were getting rid of the gay character and the gay storylines.
Yeah.
And we kind of all agreed off camera, like, well, there's nothing really to be upset about. I mean, we don't know that that's why they're doing it.
Yeah.
You know, how can we get upset if we don't really know the facts?
Yeah.
But then it did after, you know, actually, Will actually died and everything just started kind of happening. I know I personally got really worked up about it because it did
get
to that.
Which is when I was starting. I remember that.
Yeah, and it got to that where what you were just talking about is like, you know, they did such a good job telling that story.
Mm-hmm.
And the rumors we were hearing was that because it was a gay storyline and Middle America didn't want to hear it, they had to get rid of it.
Yeah.
And my voice in that was that, you know, be the change.
Yeah.
You know, it doesn't have to be the main storyline. They don't have to give them 7 days a week on air. But it is a great working storyline with amazing actors
mm-hmm.
that people are relating to and is making a difference.
Mm-hmm.
And instead of just, you know, poo-pooing it and putting it on the back burner for whatever ego reasons or whatever it is. I mean, I don't know what's going on back there. But, you know, step up and let it keep going and be this, keep up that momentum that it had.
Yeah. And they generated so much momentum almost out of nowhere. I mean, at that time, there weren't any other daytime shows with it.
And I don't think they knew how that storyline was going to go and how loved those characters were going to be.
Yeah.
And they instead listened. Yeah, I mean, again, I don't know that that's what happened, but in my head, that's what we started seeing and what we started feeling was like, we're just going to get rid of the gays.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah, although my nickname for Will was Sammy Jr. during that time.
Yes, it was.
Yeah, you know, and it was that period. It's always fun to be a bad guy, to mm-hmm. be a villain. But I didn't even feel like Will was being a villain. He was just being a little bitch.
Yeah,
he was just being a little bitch.
Yeah.
You know? Can you bleep that out? Thanks.
Sorry.
No, it's okay.
I felt okay.
We get an explicit rating every week anyway.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. But we did come up with a way to bring Will back.
Let's hear it.
On our show.
Yeah.
Because we think, because we felt like when Will came back from California.
Oh, yes.
He was a very different Will.
Yes.
Like, we felt like he just, the way he acted, everything was very different.
Mm-hmm.
So, we think it was a switch.
Like, that wasn't Will. It was like,
there
Will.
Was someone else.
It was a doppelganger.
Else. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So,
and
keep
I
the face.
Also said that it could have been Abigail's mental illness.
That she created.
That she created
in her head.
Your death.
Mm-hmm.
Oh man, people are not gonna like that.
I love it. We're trying to get you back.
And then the only thing that I can add to it is that the real Will is in California with Maxine's son having a grand time.
Jesus.
And then we both come into Salem together.
Yeah.
I like that. I like that. Yeah.
Need something to drive.
We'll keep that. So we are going to open the phone lines for you guys so that you guys can give us a call and ask your question to Guy or give him a comment. So make sure you give us a call here in the studio, and I believe the number will appear in our chat, or it's right there on the screen. Thank you, Steve. 424-253-0749. Again, that's 424-253-0749. Give us a call here in the studio. If you have a question or comment for Guy, give us a call. We would love to chat with you.
Now, you were saying that some of the writing got a little bit muddy for Will around the time of Sonny and Paul, with Will cheating on Sonny mm-hmm. with Paul. Mm-hmm. What were some of your favorite storylines as Will?
Okay, so just talking about the favorite ones overall.
Overall. Mm-hmm.
I really liked the storyline where Will was really getting going as an investigative journalist.
Yeah.
That was mm-hmm. a lot of fun.
I kept
that
saying I thought Will and Nicole should work together. Because I love Nicole in that job too.
Yeah.
It was so perfect for her.
Two nosy people.
Yeah.
That would have been great.
Yeah.
And it's great because when you have a character who's a muckraker, it's like you've created this Pandora's box where you can pull out whatever conflict mm-hmm. you want. Mm-hmm. And in a soap opera, I mean, there's anything is possible.
This is why they need to have the newspaper back and have Jack back.
Yeah. Okay.
And Will can work for Jack.
Yes.
Nicole can work for Jack.
Yeah.
We're bringing him back for the day, too,
okay,
by
cool.
the way.
Yeah. Okay, cool.
I want to ask real quick, though, because I had several people ask about you and sports.
Okay.
You do tweet a lot about sports.
Yeah, I do.
Aliveness Rising had asked about your passion for sport, how you became a fan. I don't even know what this means.
Everton FC,
and have you ever been to England to see them play? So I'm guessing they're an English sport. I watch college football, in my defense, okay? Go Bucks.
Yeah, Everton is it's a soccer team. Or a football club.
Right.
We call it soccer. Yes. So the FC stands for football.
Club. That's what
football
I thought.
Football club. Yeah.
Okay.
Based in Liverpool.
See, I'm not that dumb.
And northern England.
Okay.
And I came to fall in love with them originally. I've always wanted to since I was a kid, I've always wanted to sort of get behind an English Premier League team.
Okay.
But I've never really been to England. I was in London for a few years ago. But when the World Cup was happening in 2014,
Germany win?
Germany won.
My husband's German, sorry.
Oh, okay.
Give a shout out.
You get points for that. Tim Howard stole my heart, our goalkeeper, and mm-hmm. and I looked at him and he played for Everton. And I was like, oh, great. So this is a sign. Everton is the team. So I just started reading everything about them, watching every match, learning about all their players. And, you know, Tim Howard is no longer with Everton, but I still love them more than ever.
Ron T84 also asked if you would ever consider being a pro athlete.
Of course, if I could.
Which one would you love? Like, oh, I would love to be a pro soccer player.
You know, maybe baseball.
Baseball.
So it could go either way. Because the thing about it is, baseball. It's such a sacred game, and there's a ton of money in it. You know, I mean, even if you're just making the major league minimum, I mean, you're rich.
Yeah.
You know, whereas with soccer, I would, you know, I'd love to be a pro soccer player, but I'd be good enough that I could play abroad and not just
travel,
only playing the MLS, but play abroad. You know,
Who's your favorite MLB team?
Giants, San Francisco Giants.
Yeah.
You were born in San Francisco.
I was born in San Francisco. Yeah.
I'm not a stalker. I had to Google you for this.
Oh, that's okay.
Go Red Sox.
I don't follow you around grocery stores like Matt does.
Yeah. Well, speaking of following people around town, we do have
Billy's on the phone?
No.
Oh.
We do have a caller, though. We can go ahead and take that caller. Hello. Welcome to AfterBuzz TV Spotlight On. You are on live with us and Guy Wilson. What's your name and where are you calling from?
Hey, this is Mike Riley from New York.
New York. How are you, Mike?
I'm quite well.
Good. Thanks for calling.
Interesting, Michael.
And do you have a question or comment for Guy?
I do. Hi, Guy.
Hi.
Nice to chat with you.
You too.
I just wanted to sort of piggyback off of what you were saying before about, what all of you were saying about recast not being accepted favorably. Mm-hmm. And I think in this instance, it had a lot to do with the writing and not to do with your portrayal of of Will. Because if you really, if you compare the recasts of Chad and Will, I feel that the writing supported the Chad recast and really did a disservice to the character of Will, because they brought on two new mature Chad and Will with the intention of totally changing their personalities. And the change in Chad's personality made sense. You know, yeah. Abby had an affair with EJ, enter new angry, vengeful Chad.
Yeah.
But the mistake that they made with Will is they changed who Will was on a fundamental level.
Sure.
I mean, Will is the child who was the voice of reason to his immature mother. You know,
yeah.
He was the balance and calm to Sammy's chaos. And that was totally thrown out of the window. And now Will was written as Sammy Jr.,
yeah.
You know, equally conniving. And I think that's what was hard for the fans to swallow. So, you know, I think that's where a lot of the negative feedback came from. It wasn't your portrayal, but because you were a great, mature Will. It's just that they changed the character so drastically without any explanation.
Are you on an airplane, you know, Mike?
Sounds like an airplane's going over.
Is that us? Our side?
Is that an RN? We're in North Hollywood, so. Yeah.
Mike, I really love how you articulated that point. I mean, I think that makes perfect sense. I certainly with how they you know, how the writing supports, you know, the maturity changes in Chad, and I agree. I think just throwing this out loosely, I think with Chandler, you know, Will had this very the boyish vulnerability, which is a wonderful, beautiful thing to watch, and I think I don't have that same essence that Chandler does, and yet a lot of the writing wasn't necessarily emotionally progressive; it was almost emotionally regressive.
Mm-hmm,
you know,
mm-hmm.
I think you did.
Sure.
I think I completely agree with your analysis on that. I think that's very spot on.
Thank you. And I think also that had Chandler been the playing Will when Ben murdered him, that would have been really hard for fans to swallow, in the same way Paige's murder was hard to swallow, because we felt like we were watching children die.
Yeah.
So even though your portrayal was amazing, and the way you were, well, Will was pleading with Ben, you know, it was chilling. Really great work.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Mike, for calling.
That's it, guys.
Thank you, Mike, for calling in and always supporting us. And keep letting me know how much you are in love with Billy more than Mark.
You don't, Mike. I don't care what you say.
You had a moment.
I can have Billy tell you right now. We're having dinner.
That's not happening. But I'll talk to him next weekend in Toronto for you, Mike. Don't you worry. Don't you fret none.
All right. Good night.
Thank you, Mike.
I was just saying, when Will found out, when he had the confrontation with Ben, you had this movement where it was kind of like, oh shit, you're the killer.
You could see the light bulb go on.
Yeah,
and it was like, that was that moment you were like, oh shit, this is it. That's the one that's going to happen. Yeah, that was good.
That's that moment where I really turned into Madea, and I was like, Will, run!
Yeah.
Run!
Yeah. Jump out the window,
but
do something, get out of there.
Yeah.
It's weird. You gave me chills when you started talking about it. Mike gave me chills when he started talking about it. It was like...
Are you getting chills looking at Guy thinking about it?
Yes. Yeah, it was chilling. It was such
it was
a...
Him.
Yeah.
It was actually him!
It was you!
Well, it looks like we have another caller calling in. Let's take them. Hello, caller. Welcome to AfterBuzz TV Spotlight On. You are on live with us and Guy Wilson. What's your name and where are you calling from?
Hi, Tony. It's Lonnie.
Hi, Lonnie. How are you?
I have a question for Guy.
Yes. Hi. What is your question?
My question is, how was his experience on General Hospital when he played a young Luke?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Oh, excellent question. That was such a special day for me. I had just turned 19. I had just moved to Los Angeles, you know, and I had done a couple little, you know, podunk student things, but this was the first time I'd been on, you know, really like a big time TV show, you know, like General Hospital. So I was 19. I get there. They're still shooting there now. I was over at Prospect Studios for ABC over in Los Feliz, and. I rolled up and went in there, and it felt like I was going to Disneyland for the first time.
Mm.
It's like the Disneyland for my grown up self,
yeah.
You know, and that's just being on a soundstage. And so the experience being there with all these different, because I'd never done I mean, I hardly done anything at that point in my life, let alone multi-camera daytime television.
Yeah.
And so you've got these different cameras sort of moving around like robots, and these box sets, you know, and then these actors, these just ridiculously good-looking people who have all this confidence, yeah. and everything is like a routine for them, because it is. I mean, they do this every day.
Right.
And then there's me, and I was so initially petrified of just screwing up. And mm-hmm. and I actually did at one point. I was supposed to exit something like camera right, and I exited camera left. Something simple, you yeah. know, that mm-hmm. anyone can do. And I did it, and I realized I walked in front of the camera when that camera was filming shooting, and I had to go back and start again. And I was so mortified, so mortified, like I could cry. I was so embarrassed.
Yeah.
And then this guy walks up to me afterwards. He says, "Hey, don't worry about it." And it turns out it's Scott Clifton, who was playing Dylan Quartermain at the time. And he was so cool. And he and, oh my gosh, he played Georgie. And I'm drawing a blank.
We need James Flatt Jr.
Yeah, we can't help.
It's not our soap.
Oh my God. We follow each other on Twitter, and I'm having a brain fart.
Matt, Google him.
I am.
Matt's Googling for him.
Georgie's a she.
Yeah. play Georgie.
Lindsay Leatherman.
Lindsay with a Z. That's all I
yeah.
Lindsay
yes.
with a Z.
No yeah. pressure.
Yeah. Lindsay Leatherman. So Scott, Lindsay took myself and then the other young lady who was playing opposite me in my scenes out to pizza for lunch.
Like, oh, nice.
And treated us. It was amazing.
Did anybody at Days ever treat you to pizza?
Yes.
Oh.
Yeah, Friday.
I was trying
pizza
to
day. Yeah,
create a stir.
Nick Scalacci. Nick Scalacci, who is our head of makeup and also husband.
Lauren's,
to
Lauren's
Lauren,
husband.
Yeah, yeah. To Nikki. Lauren Coslow. Yeah, mm-hmm. Nikki, yeah. Every Friday, he would have a bunch of pizzas delivered. And
oh, I like it. I need to
work on those days.
Yeah.
I love pizza.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, Lonnie, thank you so much for calling in, and stay tuned, because right after this, we have Dish and Days coming up, where we give you a full recap of this week's episodes of Days of Our Lives.
I will. Thank you, Tony.
Thank
Hi,
you.
Mark.
Bye.
Thank you.
Hi,
thanks
there.
For calling.
Bye, guys.
Bye. Thank you.
Guy, who do you still hang out with from Days of Our Lives?
I see Freddie here and there. He's been traveling a lot. You know who I see... been seeing a lot is Rob Scott Wilson.
Me too.
He lives mm-hmm. like a block from me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so we see each other all the time. We text all the time, but then we just bump into each other at 7-Eleven or Starbucks.
Can I get those intersections?
People are going to be following you all around.
I had a nice talk with Casey Moss the other day. We've been sort of playing phone tag, but the thing about it is I could call up anyone on that show,
yeah.
and I'd be like, hey, I need to see you now, or something's come up, I need your help, and
yeah,
they'd be there. Yeah,
yeah.
It's one of those things, yeah.
I'm going to ask her a real quick question from the chat room here. It's this is that point where I have to put on my reading glasses. Kara Phoenix wants to know if you know about the hashtag Keep Calm and Love Guy Wilson tag that they made for you on Twitter.
Yeah, I do, and it made me so happy when I saw that. When I was on the show and I saw that, it made me so happy because it's. I mean, I'm. You know, like we all carry a little insecurity
yeah.
at some point, and coming onto the show, you know, as a relatively unknown actor in his mid 20s, and all of a sudden, getting so much opinion from all different directions,
yeah.
it was. You know, we talked about that,
yeah.
and it was a little overwhelming at points. So then, when I saw that hashtag, it instantly put a smile on my face.
Oh, good.
Yeah. I've known about that since the beginning. Yeah.
Once you started airing on Days, were you instantly recognizable? Were people stopping you?
I wouldn't say instantly, but what I've found is there are certain places. So obviously, there are regions around the country where it's going to be a little
right.
more prevalent. The Midwest,
mm-hmm.
for instance. But where I. Knock on wood, because I enjoy it. Let's be honest, it's fun,
right.
it's flattering
yeah.
when someone says, "Hey, I've seen."
You
know.
So you should make
yeah.
a scene
yeah.
at Pavilion.
Guy,
yes,
yeah.
yeah,
it's me. If you do a good enough show, I'll give you 5 points.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. Security at airports. TSA agents
yeah.
watch Days of Our Lives.
That's
TSA
so
security,
funny.
And so all multiple times I'll be going through security and. Someone will be like, you know, you're on Days of Our Lives. Oh my God! Take off your shoes. And
yeah.
I still have to take
right,
off.
Right, right.
It's like, you think you're gonna get like a free pass?
Yeah.
But no, you still gotta.
When I did Billy's event in Niagara Falls, he said to me, Canada, that was the most he had ever really been. I mean, just in the few times I was with him, like when we went to dinner and out for drinks and stuff after, I think he got stopped three or four times.
Yeah.
And that was within, you know, a 5-6 hour period. That's, I think, quite
that's a lot
to be stopped, you know.
So, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
How many times were you recognized, Mark?
In Canada? Just by the people in the room that knew I was there. But Billy did get a smile on his face when I walked in. Thank you, Billy Flynn.
Oh, my God.
There you go.
Let's take one more caller. Hello, caller. Welcome to AfterBuzz TV Spotlight On. You're on live with us and Guy Wilson. What's your name and where are you calling from?
Hi, it's Cheryl from South Carolina.
Well, hey, Cheryl. We've been waiting for you to call. I knew you were going to call in.
This is my first spotlight.
Oh,
I've never watched one live.
Oh, really?
Oh, good. Well, this is a good one to watch.
I just had to because it was Guy.
No. Thank you, Cheryl.
Do you have a question or comment for him?
I have an observation and I have a question for Guy.
Okay.
My observation is this, and I've said this since the beginning. I always felt like after Will came out, Chandler seemed awkward in the role.
Uh-huh.
And when Guy came in, there was never any awkwardness.
Mm-hmm.
He like owned that role.
Mm-hmm.
And I loved Will until he came back from California and became whiny bitch Will. And then I didn't really like him. But they should have never killed off a legacy character. My question is this.
Okay.
Yes.
What can we see you on now, Guy?
Yeah. Yes. Cheryl, you're so sweet. First of all, thank you for that compliment. That means so much to me. You know, it's, again, trying to bring some truth has always been my thrust, and so thank you for saying that, for that observation. As far as what now, I'm since I did my last episode for Days, I've guest starred on a couple of shows, just fun little guest stars. I mean, nothing to go crazy over, but I guest starred on Rizzoli and Isles. Mm-hmm. And
I have a list. Do you want them?
Oh yeah, there it is. And and Stitchers, and so those are just yeah, a couple guest stars. But
these,
as far as, oh yeah, oh, I've done all right.
Yeah. Okay. And a lot of like crime shows, I'm noticing.
Yes.
Yeah, I do a lot of crime.
Yeah. I'm noticing.
Yeah.
I think I'm gonna be the next big district attorney.
I could do a lawyer well.
Yeah.
So those shows are out there, but I did an independent movie called Sunflower, which is in post production, and I think it's really cool. It's got a very sort of European style to it. It's
mm-hmm.
It's a dark mystery, sort of a psychological thriller about this crew of people out at sea, and one of them goes missing. And so I portray a detective who is looking into this mystery. So that'll be out later, the second half of this year.
Okay. And so I definitely got a lot of tweets asking about that.
Yeah, so. And so, yeah, there'll be more info on that as it comes up. It's called Sunflower.
And you tell us, and we'll make sure
exactly.
We announce it on
yeah.
the show, too.
Yeah, yeah. So. Directed by Matt Shapira and produced by Hutch Dano, both good friends of mine. And then as far as other items, later this year, the start date is still TBD, but I've missed this all.
Club TBD.
Yes, Club TBD. I co-wrote a horror film, a feature film, and it's in development, and it's on pace right now to go into production at the end of this year in South Africa. And
wow.
So I'll be in South Africa at the end of the year for this.
Nice.
I co-wrote it, and I'm also producing it, and I might play a part in it. That's still TBD.
Okay.
TBD.
But, we like that.
So I'm excited about that. I mean, that's one thing I've been spending a lot of time on. Always have, but especially since Days, is writing and also cultivating a writing producing career.
Right.
In addition to acting, I'm not walking away from acting, but I feel like I have the vision and the skill set that I could really try to do some stuff if I really push myself creatively. So I've been writing a lot.
Yep.
So yeah. So that's and. Once we have a title for this, there's a working title called The Summoning for this horror, this South African
Ooh,
movie. So,
I like it.
Yeah.
Summoning.
So there'll be a lot more coming up with that as it becomes available.
Chills.
Yeah.
You're just giving us chills today.
Yeah,
guy, left
thanks.
And right.
If you need
Thank
a
you.
Fluffy drag queen, let me know.
I will. I'll let you know.
Well, thank you, Cheryl, for calling in, and make sure you stick around because we have Dishin' Days coming up next.
Yes.
Of course.
Thank
All
right.
Thank
you, Cheryl.
Bye, guys. Thank
Bye.
You, Cheryl.
Bye. Bye, Cheryl.
See you guys later.
Bye. Guy, will you do me a huge favor?
Yeah, Tony.
Will you please give Carly Kaufman a shout out? If you
yes.
look into that camera right there and just
yes.
say hello to Miss Carly Kaufman.
Yes.
Carly Kaufman, I see you in my Twitter feed. Thank you for getting a hold of these knuckleheads, and I'm thrilled to be able to give you a shout-out this afternoon. Thank you.
Yes. Yeah.
And why don't you do one, too, for Debbie Hogarth in the UK.
Oh, sure. Yeah. Hey, Debbie.
She also wanted a little shout-out and love.
Hi, Debbie.
Sorry to everybody we didn't get around to.
Right.
That's okay. This is your shout out. Yeah. What really warms my heart is all of these people. I recognize all of them from Twitter.
That's why I wrote down the Twitters.
And Instagram.
He's gonna know probably who they are by their Twitter names and stuff.
I love you guys. I mean, you guys really, really enrich and embolden my life and my life experience. Thank you for all of your kindness. Thank you.
Well, you are loved and you are truly missed on Days of Our Lives.
Thank you.
Yes. Now, before we run out of time, because, you know, we do have another show that we have to do called Dish and Days right here on AfterBuzz TV every Sunday at 4 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. No, it's totally fine. Now, who do you think Will should have ended up with? Sonny or Paul?
Sonny.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Good answer.
Yeah, Sonny.
That was a good one.
I think Paul had such an important effect on Will, because the thing about Will is he got married right away.
Right, and his first
love. Gay or straight, if you get married right away, there's going to be some red flags. And and it's noble and it's romantic, but I feel like there's something else.
I'm just saying, because I think I said that on the show. That was a quick.
So it's and I think, you know, the Paul character he's an amazing man. I mean, Christopher, is an amazing man. But the character Paul is a great guy. Yeah. And so it's not that. I mean, if anything, it would have been a step upwards for Will, because I think, you know, it's Christopher Sean. I mean, he's gorgeous. Yeah. But I think the right thing for Will was to really find out what his values, his true values are, and then correct his behavior and end up with Sonny.
Yeah, I agree 100%. Awesome.
Well, that's it. That's all the time that we have.
This was so much fun. This
was fun.
Flew by.
It always flies by.
And we got at one point, and I looked at my clock and I went, what? Yeah. There's no way we've gotten that far already. Yeah. Time flew by. Well, it was great.
Such a good time. And
I learned a lot.
Yes.
Sometimes we get done with these and I don't really, I learned a lot today.
Okay.
I won't say who. Yes. I'm kidding.
We all know.
Totally kidding.
I'm very thankful that you came in and took the time to speak with us
today. Thank you for reaching out.
Tell them it's not our fault that it took you this long to get here. Because we get blamed because you guys don't want to come right away.
Let me clarify. I don't know which camera to look into, but these guys have been, you know, trying to get at me for a little while. I've been playing hard to get. So they're doing their jobs.
I've been
following you in parking lots.
Yeah. I know, this one.
Yeah.
I've never seen her buy so many grapes in
I'll tell Tony, I saw a guy at Starbucks. He's like, did you talk to him? Like, I was on the phone, but I'm not going to be like, hi!
You just say hi. I'm like, guy is fine. Like, he's very approachable. Like, you just say hello.
Yeah. Guy, I'm from Dish and Days.
Yeah. All right, well, thank you guys so much for tuning in. And before we head out, we would like for you guys to follow us on all of our social medias. So, Mark, where can they find you and your hair?
Me and my hair. I have two, because my hair has its own Twitter. Yeah. Living for the Hair is my hair's Twitter. And then you can follow me at Lorraine Love, LORAYNELOVE, and Lorraine.love on Snapchat. Are you on yet?
I am.
Okay, do you follow me?
I don't follow you yet.
I don't really do that much.
I'll follow you.
But you can.
Guy, where can they find you?
At the Guy Wilson, THEDUYWILSON. Yeah, and that's for Twitter and Instagram. Yeah.
Perfect.
Yeah. And I think I'm going to try to figure out this Periscope thing. But
I've heard great things.
I haven't started it yet, but I think I'm going to get that. Someone's been prodding me into that, so I'm going
to
get that.
Step one is just to download it.
Yeah. I've done that. I downloaded it. Now I need to just open it, because I feel like I could do well at Periscope.
You probably could. Just open it and just let the world come in and just talk to them, and you'll be fine.
It'll be like this, but without the voices.
Yeah. You can just sit at home with you and your
without
cats
three
and just
homos
have
sitting.
A good time.
Which is not as fun, I'm telling you now.
Matthew, where can they find you?
You can find me on Instagram and Twitter at Matthew E. Paine.
And, of course, you guys can find me on all social media platforms at Lounging with Tony or my website, loungingwithtony.com. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. Guy, thank you so much for coming.
Thank you very much. Yeah, thank you guys.
And thank you guys
for watching. Periscope.
Oh, look at this. We had 130 people watching.
Oh, that's
great. Shout out to all of you guys. Thank you. And stick around, because we three will be recapping this week's episodes of Days of Our Lives on Dish and Days coming up right after this. Take care, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
from executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.